Buddha was a philosopher, a spiritual leader, and is credited as the founder of Buddhism. Often referred to as the Enlightened One, Buddha's teachings are followed to this day by millions of people around the world. He was born as Siddhartha Gautama in 566 BC into an aristocratic family in Lumbini, Nepal, and when he was 29 years old, he left the comforts of his home to seek the meaning of the suffering he saw around him, to search for a life beyond life and death. After 6 years of self-mortification, he realized that the search for divinity lies not in worldly things, but in the mind. Thus, abandoning self-mortification, he gave himself to meditation and reached a state of enlightenment. For the next 45 years of his life, he went around teaching others the path to attain this state of enlightenment. The teachings of Buddha revolve around dukkha, which means suffering, and the end of dukkha, which is regarded as the state of nirvana. The philosophy's most essential teaching includes the three marks of existence, which are as follows. 1. Anicca, which means that life is in a constant flux. 2. Dukkha, which means that life is painful and causes suffering. And 3. Anatta, which means that the self is always changing. According to Buddha, our thoughts and experiences are subject to these three marks of our existence. It is a way of understanding ourselves and the world around us, and in this video we'll be talking about the first mark of existence, anicca, to better understand the ever-changing, impermanent nature of life and how we can deal with the changes that come with that. Once, a woman named Kisa Gotami approached Buddha carrying her dead son. The heartbroken mother was looking for every possible way to bring him back. As a result, she came to Buddha hoping he could bring him back to life using medicine. Seeing the boy was already dead, Buddha used this opportunity to teach an important life lesson. Firstly, Buddha asked Gotami to bring him some mustard seeds from a house that hasn't witnessed the loss of a loved one. Gotami went door to door looking for the seeds, and slowly she realized that no such house exists. Still hoping that Buddha could revive her son, Gotami brought the seeds to Buddha. When questioned by Buddha if she bought the seeds from a house where no son or daughter, father or mother had passed away, Gotami sat weeping and realized her selfish nature as grief started to wash over her. More importantly, she realized that death is common to all, and at last she realized the reality of impermanence and buried her son in a nearby forest. Anicca in Buddhism means impermanence. The word anicca consists of two words, a meaning non, and nika meaning permanent. Everything is subject to change as it is in continuous transformation. Since being is becoming, decay is inherent in all component things, and existence remains forever in a flux or continuous becoming, like a flowing river. The water flowing through a river may appear constant and unchanging to the naked eye, but in reality, we never see the same atoms and molecules, so it cannot be the same water. The same is true of time through life. It is a progressive moment, a successive series of different moments joining together to give the impression of one continuous flow. The river of yesterday is not the same as the river of today. The river of this moment is not going to be the same as the river of the next. Life changes continuously. Once you're born, you grow, develop, become an adult until at some point you will die. In the interim, your relationships will change, your ideas and opinions will certainly change, and so will you. Everyone grows older and everything changes. Buddha explains how there are five processes over which human beings have no control: growing old, falling sick, death and destruction, decay of perishable things, and the passing away of that which is liable to pass. No one can escape these five aspects of impermanence until one achieves nirvana, the highest form of enlightenment achieved through the right attitude and awareness. In the normal course of our existence, we may not be able to escape from impermanence, but we can learn to cope with it. So with that in mind, here are four ways we can try to not only embrace life changes, but also be happy and grow with them. From the philosophy of the Buddha. Number 1. Acknowledge the change. Buddha says, "All conditioned things are impermanent." When one sees this with wisdom, one turns away from suffering. Most of us desperately prevent change from happening because we fear the unknown. But since change is inevitable, we need to develop the mindset that allows us to let things happen when they unfold, instead of approaching change from a place of denial and resistance. A trip to the beach is the perfect allegory for the changes that we experience in our daily lives and how we tend to resist them. When we go to a beach, we build a sandcastle. We get caught up in making a beautiful and perfect castle. But after a while, a tide is bound to come and destroy the whole thing, whether we like it or not. We need to cultivate the awareness that change can happen quickly and at any time. We need to cultivate this awareness through meditation. You can use meditation as a way to directly and personally consider the environment around you and its impermanent nature. At the end of every day, you can meditate by focusing on stabilizing your breath, breathing in and out slowly and deliberately, letting go of all feelings and experiences, and becoming conscious of your body and mind. Once you're comfortable, it's now time to understand the fluidity of change and the impermanence of our mind, our body, the outer world, people, and relationships. A good way to start is by thinking about yourself, how you have evolved over time, and the challenges you've encountered or are currently facing. You can also start by thinking of your close ones, like your family, and how they've changed over time. How your relationship with your spouse, parents, or children have evolved over time. Then think of your friends, how they've evolved, the hardships they may have faced or are currently facing. Think of people in your city and around the world, and all the different hardships and happinesses they may be facing at any given moment. At any moment in time, there will be a death occurring in someone's family, while at the precise same moment, some other family elsewhere on the planet must have welcomed a new life into this world. If someone must have lost their job or must have lost their fortune, someone else must have won some kind of lottery or must have gotten a promotion or pay rise at work. If someone's calling off their wedding or is getting a divorce, someone else is getting married or experiencing their first love. For every terminal diagnosis, someone else must have had a miraculous recovery. For every argument or fight with a friend, someone out there, right at that moment, will be making a new friend or creating a new, lifelong memory with an existing friend. When you meditate on all of these scenarios, you will soon realize how life can change, and any of these fortunate or unfortunate events can happen to you too. If nothing unfortunate happened to you today, be thankful for that, and see how you can be there for people around you who are less lucky. If you're going through an unfortunate phase, know that you cannot be the only one going through whatever it is, and this too will change. Acknowledge that you and everything around you is constantly evolving and you are no exception. Start by practicing this for 5 minutes every evening. If you find meditation difficult, you can also practice this exercise while on a walk under the beauty of nature. Sessions such as this will help us answer philosophical questions, providing us with truly transformative insights, helping us to understand and embrace the impermanent nature of our lives. Number 2. Practice non-attachment. In the words of Buddha, the root of suffering is attachment. Non-attachment is a very important part of understanding the philosophy of Buddhism. We often misunderstand non-attachment, specifically referring to loved ones like a spouse or children or parents. The type of non-attachment that's being talked about in Buddhist thought has less to do with what you own or with what you hold on to versus how that holds on to you. We hold on to things in an effort to find happiness and comfort. We don't just cling to things that give us joy. We also cling to some things because we're afraid to let go of them. Because of this, we suffer. And others suffer because we're holding on to things that are past their time. In Buddhism, there is a parable where, on the banks of a river, the Buddha asks his monks if somebody were to build a raft and they were to cross the river with it, would it be wise or unwise to continue their journey with the raft once they reach the other side? Letting go of the raft, whatever the raft may be, is a lesson of letting go of things that are past their time and is a simple explanation of non-attachment. This can apply to relationships, friends, and experiences. In terms of relationships, loving in a non-attached way is loving in a way that the person you love feels free. So it's not that there isn't love or that you don't want to be with someone. It's that you don't allow that person or that thing to own you. That's what Buddha means by attachment in this instance. So letting go of attachment is the secret to really enjoying life and to loving others. It's a way of freedom. Think about that with your own relationships, like for example with your children. If you love your children in a way that they feel free to be who they want to be, that's genuine non-attachment. You're allowing someone to be completely authentic and free as they are. This rule applies to other things too. Let's take achieving your goals, for example. The goals or milestones are typically not the problem. The problem is that when we allow those things to own us, it becomes unhealthy. It is completely appropriate to have goals, to have milestones that you set in your career or in various other phases of your life. There's nothing wrong with that. The problems start when we become trapped because those things own us. Having goals can be fine as long as you understand that goals are impermanent. You work towards them. You either accomplish them and move on, or something changes and it doesn't work out. That is where the wisdom of adaptability comes into play. The moment life presents something new, you can adapt to it and create a new goal, because that original goal didn't own you. You used it as a tool for yourself, not a burden that makes life more difficult. When we realize we don't have any control over life, we understand detachment and accept its impermanent nature. Additionally, we're also open to change, willing to take risks and lead healthier lives by making the right choices. Number 3. Embrace change. Buddha considers that change is never painful. Only resistance to change is painful. Most of the time, when any change happens, the outcome will not turn out the way you want. By refusing to accept this change, we actually make it worse because we're fighting against it, against the flow of life. But by embracing the situation, you deal with it far more effectively. For example, suppose your partner gets a promotion at work and they might need to work 10-hour days plus weekends. Because of this, they have to travel more often and won't have the same time as they have right now to spend with you or the family. Rather than sitting at home feeling anxious over being left alone, arguing with your partner and going against the flow of life, you need to understand and respect their choice. Free yourself from this attachment and make them feel free as well. And find a solution of your own by embracing this situation. You can indulge in your hobbies or pick up something you've always wanted to learn. You can also find local activities to do alone or with friends. Trying to keep everything fixed means we're not really changing, and therefore we're not really growing. Life is all about constantly growing in many different ways. Number 4. Learn from the experience. In our final quote from Buddha for this video, he says, "Every experience, no matter how bad it seems, holds within it a blessing of some kind. The goal is to find it." When we accept change and learn from it, change is no longer our enemy. It becomes our teacher. At its core, change pushes you to become a better person. Whenever you undergo something in your personal or professional development, while it may not seem like it at the time, these events offer lessons that help shape your future. They make you more flexible, innovative, and more aware. Change is only as scary as you make it seem. Maybe you're about to enter a new role, like starting a new business, and are fearful of failing. Everyone makes mistakes, and everyone fails at some point in their lives. So when, not if, failure happens to you, let it be an opportunity to learn and grow. Try to work through each day without concern of failure or rejection. For thousands of years, people have worked to advance life in every way. Such progress is only possible when we aren't afraid of what lies ahead. Not only do you grow as a person and make progress when you embrace change, but going with the flow and embracing that change is vital to achieving true inner peace. If you enjoyed this video, please make sure to check out our full Philosophies for Life playlist. And for more videos to help you find success and happiness using ancient philosophical wisdom, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks so much for watching.